So Facebook and Zoom appear to be ready. So we'll begin our service. If you wish to follow along with the service, you can scan the QR code right up there, or you can go to riverofgrassuu.org/2023-OOS to find the order of service there. Welcome to our multi-platform in-person and love stream service of the River of Grass Unitarian Universalist Congregation, where we gather both here in this room and also online through Zoom and Facebook Live. We celebrate all the ways we find to gather our beloved community in body and in spirit as we go and grow and flow the river way. I'm Gary Gonzalez. My pronouns are he and him. You, here in this room, we welcome you. You on Zoom or Facebook Live, we welcome you. However you made your way among us this morning, we welcome you. Let us pause to enter into this time together as we connect again with one another, with the holy by any name, and with the light of love within us all. While we remained mindful that not everyone can breathe easy, nor find it easy to breathe, let us pause here in the headlong rush of our lives to breathe into our time together. Thank you. In this congregation, it is our mission to nurture our spirits, to love intentionally, and to create a just and healthy planet in our enduring search for truth, meaning, and faith. What we share here is not an unchanging dogma, but an affirmation that we are called to be agents of love and justice, and to build a world where everyone is cherished for who they are.
As May comes to a close with its theme of creativity, we will spend some time today thinking about how we can be creative to share the values of Unitarian Universalism with our larger society, including those with opposing views. We also remember that tomorrow is Memorial Day, a difficult day of loss and remembrance. We gather today for all of these things and enter together into this time of worship with words from Reverend Tom Shade, who served the First Unitarian Church in Worcester, Massachusetts from 1999 until he retired in 2013. The words are titled, A Power at Work in the Universe. My friends, there is a power at work in the universe. It works through human hands, but it was not made by human hands. It is the creative, sustaining, and transforming power, and we can trust that power with our lives. It will sustain us whenever we take a stand on the side of love, whenever we take a stand for peace and justice, whenever we take a risk. Trust in that power. We are together held by that power. Let us now rise in body or spirit as we sing together hymn 1059, May Your Life Be As a Song. So you know we're singing it together once, and then we break into round. So if we want to be brave and have this side of the room start, and then this side of the room can come in at the second line. Okay, all right, give it a try.
Our chalice today burns with twin flames.
Ooh.
The first flame burns for those who seek and defend the right to be free to a free and responsible search for truth and meaning, so that each person may live according to conscience in a democratically elected society. The second flame burns for the defenders of freedom, working against those who would impose their own religious beliefs on others through intimidation or legislation. As we light our chalice, we say together, may we tend this fire always, ever vigilant and courageous in the struggle for freedom and justice for all. In the light of love, let us renew our covenant as we say together, love is the spirit of this congregation, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. El amor es el espíritu de esta congregación y el servicio su ley principal. Esta es nuestra gran promesa, vivir juntos en paz, buscar la verdad a través del amor y ayudarnos mutuamente.
So let us rise in body or spirit as we sing together hymn 121, We'll Build a Land.
Thank you.
In our community each week, we share pieces of our lives. This, too, takes a new form for our new normal. We take a moment here with people who love us for exactly who we are, where we are, right now. Here in the room, we share from the book here, that's here on the table in front of the podium. And before service, you can write a joy, concern, and we'll share it here in the room this morning. As William James wrote, "We are like islands in the sea, separate on the surface but connected in the deep. Let us share a moment of silent reflection, connecting us to all who are in need." We lift these things, spoken and unspoken, asking that our hearts be seen, even as we become seers of hearts, that we may serve one another and those beyond our walls with love and thankfulness today and every day. Amen, amen, amin, aho, ashe, namaste, blessed be, and so it is.
They say it's your birthday.
So for those who showed up on the birthday celebration list for June, who are not on the choir, come see me, because apparently everyone in the choir is having a birthday in June. We sustain and strengthen this beloved community and its work in our world through the gifts of our time, our skills, our love, and yes, our money. Each Sunday, half of our undesignated offerings go to LifeNet for Families, which provides meals, clothing, and support for those in need here in Broward County. The other half supports the mission and ministry of River of Brass. You can scan the QR code or text the number on the screen to donate. You can also find several ways to give on the donate page on our website at riverofgrassuu.org. Ushers, please come forward. Now, Diane Diaz has a wisdom tale for us. So, the young at heart, the flexible, the people with strength to go from sitting to standing on a floor, come on up. So,
is this good?
Yeah.
Good morning. Today's wisdom story is by Erica Hewitt and Paul S. Sawyer, honoring fallen soldiers. Think of where you feel safe and at peace. What's the signal that tells you it's okay to be at peace? Do you know? Yeah? A circle, and is that the peace sign? Okay, so you think of that? Okay. Any other ideas? From the old'uns as well as the young'uns? Okay. For people in the United States military, there's a special signal that says, you're okay and you're at peace. It's a melody called TAPS, and it's only 24 notes long. It was composed by a general in the Civil War and his bugler. It's hard to remember how important bugle calls were in the military once upon a time. In the days before radio, bugle calls were the only way military units could communicate to groups over a large area. In the 1860s, the end of the day was important. If there was time and peace enough to play taps, that was a signal that the camp was relatively safe. It meant that you were not under attack. It meant that there were no enemy soldiers to worry about. To a camp of soldiers, the taps meant that unless you were on duty, you could close your eyes and sleep in peace. They say that the first time taps was played at a service for fallen soldiers also took place during the Civil War. In those days, the traditional military salute was, as it still is, the firing of a three-round volley of rifles. But this one time, they say, was after a long battle when finally a ceasefire had been called, bless you, and both sides had stopped to bury their dead. In one camp, as the work ended and the memorial service began to take shape, the soldiers knew that sounding the artillery salute might be taken as a return to fighting and not as a sacred memorial. Oh my gosh, someone had the idea of sounding a bugle, and the sound would never be taken as an aggressive act of war. Taps came to mean the same thing. It meant the safe and quiet end to the day. Time to rest, time to turn out the lights, to let their eyes close. That's what taps means. It's like a powerful prayer. Now let's listen to it. Renato will be playing it, not on a bugle, but on a wind synthesizer. We try to make our congregation a place where people can feel safe and at peace. We work outside of these walls to create a community like that too, a world where everyone feels peace in their neighborhoods and towns. And remember also, this weekend, many people in the U.S. are remembering and honoring all those who've died while serving in our military. So you might hear taps again. If you do, maybe you can stop what you're doing and think of every soldier who might have been afraid. Then let taps remind you they are now at peace. And now let's sing our young ones off to class.
Let us now read together the words from Eternal Mystery by Reverend Carol Meyer. Please read the italicized words after I read the plain text. May we open ourselves ever more fully to that eternal mystery which lures us onward toward life and creativity. May we know the fullness of love without fear and the serenity of peace without turmoil. Our message today is titled, Answering the Religious Right with the Big Heart of Universalism. It was written by Scott W. Alexander. Scott Alexander is the editor of Salted with Fire, Strategies for Sharing Faith in Growing Congregations, AIDS and Your Religious Community, and The Welcoming Congregation, Resources for Affirming Gay, Lesbian, and Bisexual Persons. He currently serves as minister at the River Road Unitarian Church in Bethesda, Maryland. His sermon was available on the UUA Worship website, and I updated it with some current events and shortened it for time. As it must be obvious to every one of you, these are times of great tension and conflict in America. Much of this turmoil in our nation is focused on what many observers have called the culture wars, the very vocal and visible battles that are occurring on many fronts to determine whose values, principles, beliefs, and perspectives will determine the shape of American life. In particular, over the last several years, religious and cultural conservatives are waging a fierce battle against what they perceive to be the evils of liberalism, including the availability of abortion and sex education, the affirmation and protection of gay, lesbian, bisexual, and trans persons, and the cultural inclusion of minorities and women by means of multiculturalism and feminism, to name just a few. Fundamentalist Christians and others are passionately convinced that there has been a dangerous erosion of old standards of American life, a dangerous shift away from the assumptions and ideas that they believe built and sustained our nation. And here in Florida, we are all too aware of the more recent attack on woke, and liberal values have lost some ground recently as we see abortion rights being taken away and restrictions on education that devalue the multicultural diverse communities in which we live, and then blatant attacks on our trans friends just for being who they are. Just this week, Target pulled LGBTQ pride items from shelves due to pressure from conservative activists, while Texas legislators tried to pass a bill to mandate posting the Ten Commandments in every classroom. So we cannot deny that there is now a war being waged in America. The intellectual and spiritual battle lines have been drawn, and a very important struggle is underway between competing ideas and values, between competing visions of what American society is going to look and feel like in the coming years. I believe it is crucial that we Unitarian Universalists not sit on the sidelines of these culture wars. As religious people with a good and decent vision for humans and society, We must speak up and stand up for our values and beliefs. Speak up and stand up for the principles that give our religion its large heart and enduring beauty. The cultural and religious struggle we are now in may seem like a new thing. It did to me. But actually, nothing could be further from the truth. In fact, 200 years ago, Universalism arose in just such a time of deep societal conflict. In the beginning, American Universalism, like its spiritual sister, American Unitarianism, began as a radical and optimistic Christian heresy in response to the grim doctrines of 18th century Calvinistic Puritanism. Let's take a look at two of the great preachers of that day, Jonathan Edwards and Hosea Ballou. Jonathan Edwards was a Puritan's Puritan, who was the most renowned preacher of what was called the Great Awakening, an early version of a born-again Christian fundamentalist revival that occurred in the late 1700s. The substance and soul of the predominant Calvinistic theology of the day was that God was a distant, angry, and stern judge, humanity a fallen and sinful beast, and most men, women, and children are doomed to a hell of eternal damnation and misery for all their weakness and wickedness. Delightful. In direct contrast to Edwards, the greatest universalist theologian and preacher of the day, Reverend Hosea Ballou, held his large congregation spellbound as he gently and joyfully proclaimed the gospel of universal salvation. Ballou and the other early American Universalists bravely preached a gospel of inclusion, reconciliation, and hope right in the face of Calvinistic negativity. Gospel that unashamedly affirmed the oneness and worth of all persons. This is the large and embracing spirit of Universalism, the big and beautiful heart of Universalism, the deep and compassionate conviction our Universalist forebears had in the basic, deep down, unquenchable goodness of creation, human society, and people. It's a wild and welcoming doctrine our Universalist forebears bequeathed to us. And that doctrine can be summed up in stark simplicity. There is a place set in this creation for every last man, woman, and child. A precious, safe place has been set for each and every one of us, period. A precious, safe place has been set for each and every one of us. And it is our human job to respect, protect, and nurture the well-being of all the diversity of humankind. The early Universalists said, pure and simple, that every human being, no matter how strange or flawed or unlovable or broken or weird they may seem to you, is to be protected, cherished, welcomed, and loved. Now, this is not an easy faith to have in these times. Our time has so much human violence, cruelty, and degradation. This is not an easy time to believe in the worth and redeemability of all people and society. But Universalism, you see, Universalism then and now, is not a naive and foolish faith. It is rather a tenacious faith. Universalism is the promise not to give up on people, but to keep struggling in our broken world for the improvement and inclusion of all, even those one might naturally, or even rightly, despise, reject, condemn, or judge. They simply refuse to give up on people. They saw in humanity oneness and worth more than separateness and sin. But as everyone in this room is no doubt painfully aware, many in our culture do not see this. Just as in 1793, when the Puritans and Universalists were theologically battling in the public square for the hearts and minds of the American people, once again today there is a struggle, a very real struggle, over the soul of our nation. Today, the religious right, who, as you all know, are fervently vocal, fiercely organized, and frightfully well-funded, is preaching the same negative and judgmental human message that Jonathan Edwards preached 200 years ago. The theological and social message of the religious right is the exact opposite of Universalism's tenacious acceptance of every human person. And this is not new either. It was in 1992 when Pat Buchanan, seeking the presidential nomination, spoke at the National Republican Convention and declared a culture war. That's where it comes from. Against all who have different lifestyles, beliefs, values, worldviews, even social and political philosophies. And now we're experiencing this very personally here in Florida, as abortion rights are taken away and trans rights are taken away, and what our children are allowed to learn and read is strictly regulated. This week, again, even a poem written by the National Youth Poet Laureate, Amanda Gorman, performed before the entire country at Biden's inauguration, can be censored in this new attack on woke. As if we should all just go back to sleep and allow our society to be structured to only benefit the wealthy, able-bodied, white, male, cisgendered, heterosexual Protestant. Surely it is clear to everyone in this room today that we ignore a modern-day Jonathan Edwards and his angry, narrow, and hateful religious vision at our own peril. I believe with all my heart and soul that in this time of culture wars, we must answer the religious right. We must answer them, pure and simple, with the truth that is universalism. We must boldly and unashamedly share our good news that every man, woman, and child of this creation, be they young or old, black or white, rich or poor, yellow or brown, liberal or conservative, gay or straight, beautiful or broken, is a valuable creature fashioned out of high and holy stuff for whom a place at life's table has been set. Wherever we are, however we find ourselves stationed in life, we must share that faith, tell that truth, live that ethic, and dare that dream. We must unashamedly stand up in this culture and without arrogance or vitriol, give voice to our theological beliefs just as our universalist forebears did. We must speak and live and share the generous heart of universalism. We must be evangelists. That's right, evangelists. Willing to speak up for the kind and generous truth that is universalism. Now I realize that the word evangelist may carry extremely negative connotations for many of you, but it may be that the only reason you think so poorly of evangelists is that next to nobody who thinks or feels as you do religiously ever engages in the process of publicly sharing their faith. Unitarian Universalists are notoriously spiritually silent because we demand to think for ourselves, are respectful of human difference, and don't appreciate it when someone else tries to ram their beliefs down our throats. We tend to shy away from, even cautiously and respectfully, sharing with others what it is we believe and how those beliefs help us strive to be better, kinder, larger people. I know it's hard to talk back to fundamentalism by talking up our own faith, but I passionately believe we cannot afford such a self-imposed silence in dangerous and divisive times such as these. We can wish it all we want, but the truth is that Trumpism and the culture war of anti-woke are not going to just fade away. They're out there in the public square, on the public airwaves. They're running candidates in local elections and taking over school and library boards, town and county offices, and national party structures. And unless there are other gentler visions for the human family being given voice, their divisive, mean-spirited, and hateful message will be the only one heard and the only one believed. If we remove ourselves from the religious playing field by being too nice, polite, or non-confrontational to even say what it is we believe and why we believe it, and strive to live in accordance with it, then they will carry the day and have their way with both us and the world, and that neither we nor humanity can afford. So let us be a kind, gentle, respectful evangelist for that hopeful, inclusive human vision bequeathed to us by our universalist forebears. The stakes are too high for anything less. And it's not simply enough to speak up about universalism with our lips, we must speak it with our lives, with the deeds and doings of our hands and hearts. As universalism says, and now please read the italicized text after I say the normal text. Universalism says, if there is a neighbor that needs a hand, if there is a mouth that needs fed, if there is a family that needs a home, if there is a captive who needs release, if there is a mourner who needs comfort, if there is a charity that needs support, if there is a stranger who needs welcome, if there is someone crying, this is the demanding call of universalism. I pray that in the days and years ahead, we who call ourselves Unitarian Universalists will speak the generous, inclusive, affirming spirit of Universalism. Speak it until everyone across this great and troubled land hears the holy and inclusive message that we are one. Amen. Let us rise. Thank you. Let us rise in body or spirit as we sing together words from Pat Wichter, Love is the Water. Gary's going to lead us.
Say you want to be left alone. You say love only made you weep and moan. Well, let me tell you something that you know in your bones. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that won't be stopped. I said love is the water that wears down the rock. Say your soul's like a dry riverbed, top waiting for the water long ago you said. Better pray all night for the rain instead. Love comes like a tidal wave over your head. Now, love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the power that won't be stopped. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Say waiting for love takes too long. Dulls a sharp mind and weakens a strong. Well, you may be right, but you may be wrong. Cause love can make a mountain come tumbling down. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that won't be stopped. I said love is the water that wears down the rock. River washes over every woman and man, feet in the gravel and mud in your hands. Nothing can stand against love's command. Every boulder turns into a grain of sand. Now love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the power that won't be stopped. Now love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the power that won't be stopped. I said, love is the water that wears down the rock. Again, love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that wears down the rock. Love is the water that won't be stopped. I said, love is the water that wears down.
That was by Pat Wichter, phenomenal songwriter, great musician. At River of Grass, we offer many ways to live our Unitarian Universalist faith in action. You'll find them in our weekly email, our Facebook page and website, riverofgrassuu.org. In our sermons by Tanya Gustafson. Here are some upcoming opportunities to fulfill the mission and vision of this congregation and other announcements for the life of this beloved community. In our small group of kids today, our children are exploring the creative power of music which can help people grieve this Memorial Day, or honor the struggle for justice, or celebrate life's victories. They are learning about the origin of jazz from African tribal chants mixed with Christian hymns by enslaved people in the United States. For more information, please contact our Faith Development Director, Karen Gonzalez, at religiouseducator@riverofgrassuu.org. We will celebrate a new member ceremony during worship service on June 4th. If you have found your spiritual home at River of Grass and would like to become a member, please let membership@riverofgrassuu.org know, and or minister@riverofgrassuu.org. You can let them know as soon as possible. Members of all UU congregations are invited to attend an information session on a resolution that we will be voted on at General Assembly on June 24th through June 25th. The resolution is titled Complete Divestment from the Fossil Fuel Industry and Subsequent Reparations. The info sessions will be held Saturday, June 3rd at 1 p.m. and Sunday, June 4th at 6 p.m. I'm signed up for the Saturday workshop. You must register for the sessions. See the email from our board president, Kathy Jens Rokow, for the link, or for those on Zoom, it is in the chat. After reviewing the proposal, please send any comments to Kathy at president@riverofgrassuu.org, who will share them with our delegates so they are informed as to our congregation's wishes on this matter at GA. So if you want to have an impact on what happens to this resolution, you can show up at sign up and show up at these workshops and make your voice heard. The election of a new UUA president will happen at GA this June. To learn more about Reverend Dr. Sophia Betancourt, please join the last webinar coming up on June 3rd. See the weekly email for further information. And again, you must register to attend. Please join us on Saturday, June 17th at Bergeron Park from 9 a.m. to around noon to celebrate Juneteenth. This year is a congregation-wide event sponsored by Faith Development and Membership. We have drinks, snacks, games, and a competition for those who want to test their knowledge about this important holiday celebrating the end of slavery in this nation. Contact Karen Gonzalez at Religious Educator at riverofgrassuu.org or Leanna Bresnahan at membership@riverofgrassuu.org for more information. Please see the weekly email and website for more information about these announcements and all other announcements.
We extinguish this chalice, but its light lives on in the minds and hearts and souls of each one of you. Carry that flame with you as you leave this place and share it with those you know, with those you love, and most especially with those you have yet to meet. From Brian Keeley. In these changing times, let us be all the more vigilant to hold before us a vision of the world transformed and dare to transform ourselves to make it so. Until we meet again, shine on. Thank you, those on Zoom, for joining us today.